whoever takes it upon themselves to study cinematic history at the turn of the millennium and the onset of the internet is going to have to wrestle with a potentially uncomfortable reality. A year after it had first been uploaded, as the 9/11 conspiracy documentary Loose Change began to really hit its stride as a media phenomenon, Vanity Fair wrote that it just might be the first internet blockbuster. Well, now, with an additional 15 years of context, it's no longer speculation. We can safely say that our online cultural experience began with an opening salvo of explosive data points, rapid-fire editing, and a controlled demolition of the status quo, all neatly wrapped in a whodunit ripped from the headlines. The success of Loose Change was indicative of a widespread change in public mindset and people beginning to question official narratives, both in the sense of conspiratorial skepticism as well as rejecting traditional storytelling in their consumption of media.
You need to go back to the beginning. It's just like reading a book. You know, you need to start a book at the beginning. And this is one of the things about Sync that I feel has a slightly sinister twist to it, is that you enter into it. It's like a gyroscope, you know? And you can't really know what the beginning is.
I love this image. Like any good meme, it is iconic, even hieroglyphic, in that it conveys a ton of cultural and contextual information. And part of that is an expression of hopelessness in trying to convey these sprawling spiderweb of data, the many lines of connections, without sounding like a lunatic. To present this information in spoken language or in a film is very difficult. One often ends up bending and breaking the web to place it on a linear axis. However, by 2001, the relatively new internet had introduced hyperlinks, which gave us the ability to comprehend what it would be like to hold a three- or four-dimensional encyclopedia in our hands. As the internet was coming into prominence and dominance, and these concepts were being grokked for the first time, that same technology in every home was providing access to video editing programs and unfettered outlets for online distribution. And, of course, there was a pretty remarkable event that sort of dominated the news at the time. So it actually shouldn't be that surprising that the first video to successfully translate a spiderweb narrative to somehow convey that complexity of information in a way that everyone could understand was not some art house abstraction, but the all too real harbinger of some post-postmodern art movement. Something intimately tied to and reflecting the changing world in which it was born. A new epoch had begun, and the way we process information was starting to adapt to it. We can see this clearly in the very name of what would have to be the second internet blockbuster, a film called Zeitgeist. A title which translates to Spirit of the Age, and basically means, hey, this is the feeling or thought process that defines this point in history. So again, yeah, looking back on the years that have passed, I would say that film's title turned out to be dead on the money. Zeitgeist the movie, first released in 2007, is a three-pronged presentation that attacks traditional notions about religion and economics, but only after giving a crash course version of Loose Change, re-exploring 9/11 for the second third of the film. Here tonight, we're going to aim to do even better. Let's see if we can get it down to 1 minute with the help of James Corbett. I want to see if we can get flagged by YouTube as a conspiracy video. Then they'll add some pop-up links to Wikipedia and stuff. I don't know, somewhere around this part of the screen, maybe. Thereby adding even another level of complexity to our non-linear media environment. That would be fascinating. Come on, 9/11 conspiracy in 60 seconds. Let's try it.
19 men armed with box cutters directed by a man on dialysis in a cave fortress halfway around the world using a satellite phone and a laptop directed the most sophisticated penetration of the most heavily defended airspace in the world, overpowering the passengers and the military combat trained pilots on four commercial aircraft before flying those planes wildly off course for over an hour without being molested by a single fighter interceptor. These 19 hijackers managed to knock down three buildings with two planes in New York, while in Washington, a pilot who couldn't handle a single-engine Cessna was able to fly a 757 in an 8,000-foot descending 270-degree corkscrew turn to come exactly level with the ground, hitting the Pentagon in the budget analyst office where DoD staffers were working on the mystery of the $2.3 trillion that Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld had announced missing from the Pentagon's coffers in a press conference the day before, on September 10th, 2001. Luckily, the news anchors knew who did it within minutes.
Osama bin Laden.
And the evidence literally fell into the FBI's lap.
That a hijacker's passport was found blocks from the World Trade Center crash site, if you can believe that.
Well, of course I didn't believe that, and neither did a lot of people. According to a May 2006 Zogby poll, 42% of Americans believed that the U.S. government and the 9/11 Commission concealed or refused to investigate critical evidence that contradicts their official explanation of the September 11th attacks. 42%? If those statistics are anywhere near accurate, that's almost half the country calling bullshit and asking hard questions. But there was more than just a conspiracy. There were other 9/11 mysteries starting to reveal themselves. And, well, if questioning whether or not a handful of rich, old, neoconservative white guys would be willing to kill a ton of poor brown people in the streets of New York City and then across the globe just to profit off oil and bloated military expenditures was a weird question to ask, the questions got even weirder once people started looking at images like this one. This is the cover to the Coup Party Music album. According to Wikipedia, this cover art was created in June 2001 and was originally scheduled for release in September of that year. But after the September 11th attacks, the band decided to postpone the album's release until November so they could create new cover art. And that's kind of interesting, right? This artwork is created just 3 months before the event. You know, it looks so similar. At one point, it was going to come out the same month that 9/11 happened. That's really weird, right? But I don't know, maybe it's just me. For some reason, I can't seem to figure out why Wikipedia has removed what would seem to be a much more interesting detail of the story and a much more specific time frame for the level of accuracy we'd want from an encyclopedia. See, literally just days after 9/11, Wired magazine published this tidbit from the album's label manager. Quote, "Timing of the original album printing was disturbingly in sync with real-world events. The printers were set to crank out copies of the fiery World Trade Center image on Tuesday," Isabella said, when the label put in a last-minute call, urging them to stop the presses. So yeah, this image at the printer on 9/11, crazy, right? I still don't know which news item is harder to believe. This one or the 9/11 hijackers' paper passport being found on the ground when the airplane's black boxes weren't even recovered? They're both such bizarre stories. Only one of them tricked millions of us into supporting endless war for profit, the upheaval of our judicial system, and the subjugation of our own freedom, but they're both really strange stories. And I want to focus on the second one because even if it didn't have such obvious effects on the world at large, it did inspire a hunt for answers every bit as passionate, albeit on a much smaller scale.
Yeah, have if you've been with us all day, been showing these pictures over and over again. They are dramatic, they are a story, they are what happened. And they are unlike anything we have ever seen before. In real life.
it was actually flush with the Twin Towers, this building. It's called the Millennium Hilton. It's actually intentionally designed to look like the 2001 monolith. And this object, this black monolith that in the film opens the Stargate in 2001, is flush with the World Trade Center, the Twin Towers.
These investigations into pop culture elements existing seemingly out of linear time brought with them a series of philosophical problems. Just as 9/11 conspiracies were ushering in a so-called truth movement, the hunt for, shall we say, a more ultimate truth began in earnest. In 2007, 4 months before Zeitgeist was released, an obscure little 10-minute video on YouTube blended conspiracy with this high weirdness in a package that perfectly skimmed the edges of the reality that was bending around it. This video from Jake Kotze, yet another focusing on 9/11, would be the first emergence of what would evolve into the synchromysticism school and sync films as a genre. Although the genre wouldn't have its moment of recognition till 8 years later, when it again returned to the topic of 9/11 for Joe Alexander's headline-grabbing viral video, Back to the Future Predicts 9/11.
The night that I go back in time, you will be shot by terrorists. Please take whatever precautions are necessary to prevent this terrible disaster.
In the 1985 classic, Back to the Future, at a scene called the Twin Pines Mall, we will bear witness to a sudden surprise terrorist attack, perpetrated by a group of Muslim terrorists.
Shot by terrorists.
The attack is at the Twin, which is a reference to the Twin Towers. When we turn the sign upside down, the digits on the clock read 911 or 911. The Twin Pines are a symbolic representation of the Twin Towers. Before the terrorist attack, the Twins are present, but after the attack, the Twins are gone, replaced with a single pine. This takes place on 9/11, where the Twins are destroyed and replaced with a single tower, the One World Trade Building. Also at this scene, Doc shows us two stopwatches, both of which display encoded 9/11s. Is this only a coincidence?
Back to the Future isn't the only film that strangely foreshadows this historical flashpoint, as David Plait's nearly 8-hour video response, Everything Predicts 9/11, makes abundantly clear. However, there are some examples that are more striking than others. In particular, if you watch the 1983 Dan Aykroyd and Eddie Murphy comedy Trading Places, a few things leap out at you. First and foremost has to be, holy shit, why is Dan Aykroyd doing blackface in this film, and why didn't anyone stop him? Once you get past that, you might notice a number of bizarre correlations to 9/11, the likes of which we've been discussing today. I was starting to make a list of all the 9/11 weirdness in Trading Places when I noticed a name in the credits that stood out to me. Aaron Russo. You see, I told you that Loose Change was the first internet blockbuster, and Zeitgeist was the second. But sandwiched in the center of these is one more video worth our attention. While it didn't have quite the same popularity, as well as not being on the subject of September 11th, 2006's America, Freedom to Fascism was a widely circulated conspiracy video dealing with taxation as theft and the threat of humanity being microchipped. It was also directed and edited and narrated and everything by Aaron Russo, the same guy who produced Trading Places. It gets weirder. See, somewhere between releasing the documentary Freedom to Fascism and his death just 1 year later, a short clip of Aaron talking about 9/11 became a major talking point on all the conspiracy sites. And for good reason, as his claims are pretty stunning.
And he'd tell me about business investments that he get involved in, you know, or they would help me with this business investment or that business investment. And was I interested in joining the Council on Foreign Relations? You know, I would have to get a letter to join them, but was I interested in that? He's the one who told me 11 months before 9/11 ever happened that there was going to be an event. Never told me what the event was going to be, but there was going to be an event, and out of that event, we were going to invade Afghanistan to run pipelines from the Caspian Sea. We were going to invade Iraq, you know, to take over the oil fields, establish a base in the Middle East. And sure enough, later 9/11 happened. And I remember he was telling me how how you're going to see soldiers looking in caves for people in Afghanistan and Pakistan and all these places. He says, there's going to be war and terror. And he's just laughing. There's no, who are we fighting? I mean, why do you think 9/11 happened and then nothing's happened since then? Do you think that our security is so great here that these people who pulled off 9/11, who were able to, can't knock down another plane? Come on, it's ridiculous. 9/11 was done by people in our own government and our own banking system to perpetuate the fear of the American people into subordinating themselves to anything the government wants them to do.
Remembering this clip, I was suddenly faced with the possibility that maybe everything doesn't predict 9/11. Maybe a few dudes actually had foreknowledge and were using our 80s comedies as unlikely warnings of major disaster. I struggled to wrap my mind around this seemingly ridiculous, yet undeniably real possibility. When I went back and re-watched the full Russo clip for the first time in a decade, I had forgotten that Russo gives a time frame for his pre-knowledge of 9/11 and states that he didn't start hanging with Nick Rockefeller till the late 90s.
He's the one who told me 11 months before.
11 months before. However, Trading Places came out in 1983, nearly 20 years before 9/11. Therefore, Trading Places, a film filled with 9/11 imagery and made by someone who is publicly on the record as claiming to have advanced knowledge of the event, is nonetheless definitively not an intentional warning, and instead returns us to questioning linear perceptions of time and wondering just how our artworks so perfectly foreshadow our lives. And now that we have accumulated all this context, I think we can end tonight right back where we started. Loose Change, while it may have been a runaway success, it didn't take off till its second draft. No, I'm not talking about those second edition or final cut re-releases where they attempted to fact-check themselves or find better ways to present the info. I'm talking about a film with the exact same title and the exact same production crew and cast of characters, even with the same plot. But this one wasn't a quote-unquote truth documentary. Rather, it was very much fiction. Returning to that Vanity Fair article, we read, when he started writing this film, also called Loose Change, he was 18. Avery says, I was supposed to be making a fictional story about me and my friends discovering that 9/11 was an inside job. And basically, that happened in real life. It wasn't supposed to be true. And then it was, well, do I keep making this a fictional film, or do I focus on the real thing and write about what really happened? And that's where I went with it. Life imitating art, after all. Loose Change, our first internet blockbuster, the harbinger of a billion more conspiracy videos, the harbinger of multi-dimensional narrative structures, the launching point for untold careers in activism and research, and it wasn't even supposed to be true. A little piece of fiction that grew beyond itself and became all too real. We swim in these waters regularly. We are surrounded by contradiction after contradiction in a most unusual time in history. And yet, That still makes my jaw drop. These kids wrote themselves into the story and accidentally erased the fourth wall in the process. The walls, the entire structure, it all came down. And the safety net that caught us is just that, a net, a web of seemingly infinite complexity, and the only indication of the paths that await us.